Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
Alleluia. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you have prepared for those who love you such good things as surpass our understanding. Pour into our hearts such love towards you, that we, loving you in all things and above all things, may obtain your promises, which exceed all that we can desire. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from Acts. While Peter was still speaking, the Holy Spirit fell upon all who heard the word. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astounded that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles, for they heard them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter said, "Can anyone withhold the water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" So he ordered them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they invited him to stay for several days. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people. Thanks be to God.
Together we pray Psalm 98. Sing a new song to God, who has done marvelous things. With your right hand, O God, and your holy arm, you have won for yourself the victory. You have made known your victory. Your righteousness have you openly shown in the sight of the nations. You remember your mercy and faithfulness in the house of Israel, and all the ends of the earth have seen the victory of our God. Shout with joy to God, all you lands. Lift up your voice, rejoice, and sing. Sing to God with the harp and the voice of song, with trumpets and the sound of the horn. Shout with joy before God who reigns in majesty. Let the sea make a noise and all that is in it, the lands and those who dwell therein. Let the rivers clap their hands, and let the hills ring out with joy before the Lord, who will come to judge the earth. God shall judge the world in righteousness and the peoples with equity.
A reading from 1 John. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God, and everyone who loves the parent loves the child. By this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and obey his commandments. For the love of God is this, that we obey his commandments. And his commandments are not burdensome, for whatever is born of God conquers the world. And this is the victory that conquers the world, our faith. Who is it that conquers the world, but the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is the one who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ, not with the water only, but with the water and the blood. And the Spirit is the one that testifies, for the Spirit is the truth. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Holy Gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Jesus said to his disciples, "As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends, if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You do not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear much fruit. Fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask of him in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Before I jump into the sermon, I'd like to acknowledge Mother's Day and recognize all the mothers in our midst. You know, COVID has made this a year like no other for you and for all parents, so I'd like to give a shout out to you. And I'd also like to remember all our mothers who are no longer with us, but whose influence over our lives continues. So may God, the mother of us all, bless you and keep you, guide you, support you, direct you. In the gospel reading for today, we hear Jesus say, "You did not choose me, but I chose you, and I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last." We like to think we are in control, managing our lives, taking charge, but here Jesus says, "I chose you, I appointed you." Today's reading from Acts gives a vivid picture of what that looks like. To be chosen, to be appointed. And I think of this as really a second Pentecost story because it so clearly echoes the more familiar story that we'll hear in a couple of weeks. A crowd is gathered, Peter preaches, recounting God's saving acts through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. And then in the portion of the story we hear today, God's Spirit is poured out on all those gathered. By the power of the Spirit, they spoke in tongues, just as the crowd did at the first Pentecost. And witnessing the Spirit being poured out, Peter says, "Can anyone withhold the water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit?" Now, what's remarkable about this gathering is that it includes Peter and the other disciples of Jesus who were Jews, and Cornelius and his family and friends who were Gentiles. And what's also notable, is that this crowd didn't actually choose to come together. If you read the whole story, it's clear that God was choosing them to be together. God was choosing Peter to be with Cornelius, a Gentile, the kind of person he had been taught previously to avoid, have nothing to do with. But God chose them to be together so that these Gentiles could receive the Holy Spirit and become a part of God's redeeming story. And after the baptism, Peter and his friends don't leave. They stay with Cornelius and his friends for several days. They eat and drink with them. One community. It's hard to overstate how radical this was. It was not something Peter would ever have chosen to do, but God chose him. It was so radical, in fact, that in the next chapter of Acts, we hear how Peter goes to Jerusalem to meet with the other believers, and they chastise him for what he has done. Why did you go to uncircumcised men and eat with them? To which Peter replies, the Spirit told me to go with them and not to make a distinction between them and us. God chose them, the Spirit chose them, brought them to be together, to be a community, not defined by their religious or ethnic heritage, but by the Spirit of God, the power of love, which came down on them, overwhelmed them, and moved between and among them. As we hear in the gospel, I am giving you these commands, I am choosing you so that you might love one another. This story leads me to reflect on who God is choosing for us to be with. Who is God leading us to? The experience of our consolidation has been powerful. And for me, it has been powerful because I know this wasn't all our own choosing. It really wasn't. God chose us to be together. During May, we celebrate and tell the stories of our partnership with our friends in Haiti. And when I hear these stories, again, it's clear this didn't happen just by our own choosing. God chose us to be together, to pour out the Spirit upon us, to wash away the differences and barriers between us by the power of the love that moves amongst and within us. We are moving into the next phase of our consolidation. Soon we'll be able to gather face to face, at least in limited ways. As we begin to regather, I hope we'll be guided by the example of this second Pentecost story. I hope we will be humble enough and wise enough to let the Spirit choose the community we become. We're on the way. The draft vision statement that the integration committee put together begins by stating our intention to be an inclusive community that follows Jesus by loving our neighbors. That is a vision that opens the door for God to choose for us new relationships, to bring us into a more expansive, vital, and diverse community. Many of you are familiar to one degree or another with the Peacecraft project and work we've done over the past few years. This work is focused on connecting with our neighbors and communities in more vital ways. The grant we received came from Augsburg University. The work they fund is based on a theological model they call the public church framework. And this model is based on the belief that we need to know what the gospel means in the here and now. It's an approach to Christian formation and discipleship that begins with a movement out into the public square rather than beginning in church doctrine. For so long, we have thought about the church as having something, containing something that we need to bring people into. The private church, if you will. Come and join us. But this public church framework suggests that being the church is not about bringing people into our space so much as it is going out into the community to experience where and how God is working. That is precisely what Peter did. He went out to Cornelius. This story is a picture of the public church, God's church without boundaries or walls. And that's what we're talking about when we commit to being an inclusive community by loving our neighbors. We're committing to becoming a public church. I think we have lots of ideas for where this could lead us. There are neighbors and organizations and causes we want to be closer to. The adult forum presentation last Sunday by Bob Yeager stimulated us to think about how our very church building could be a public building, a public space, not just a private space for us. And it all starts by taking to the heart the words Jesus spoke. I have called you friends because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. So let's be attentive to what the Spirit is choosing for us, where the Spirit is leading us. Peter didn't expect to find himself with Cornelius and a crowd of Gentiles, but God chose that for him. What is the Spirit choosing for us? And as we discern that, we can take confidence in these words from John's epistle. God's commandments are not burdensome, for whatever is born of God conquers the world. Amen.
In the assurance of eternal life given at holy baptism, let us proclaim our faith and say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In the words that our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Risen Christ, we thank you for bringing us from death into new life. We thank you for the light of your love which shines in our hearts. May others see this light in us and through us be drawn to you. Alleluia. Hear us, risen Lord.
Righteous God, we pray for the world. We pray that we will not become consumed by fear and darkness. Your promise is that you will never leave us nor forsake us. We claim that promise in these difficult days and thank you for your faithfulness. Alleluia. Hear us, risen Lord.
Renewing God, we lift up this church and ask your blessing for all who have been charged with this leadership. Michael, our presiding bishop, Craig, our bishop, and all those who guide our community here at Saints Luke and James. May each be wise in matters of stewardship and attentive to the new work of your Spirit amongst us. Alleluia. Hear us, risen Lord.
Restoring God, we ask that your healing presence be known in the lives of all we name before you. Annette, Barb and Jim, Betty, Brandon, Karen, Charlie, Colleen, David S., Doug, Yvonne, Gail, Gordon, Jack H., Jane, Jerry, Julia, Kathy B., Kelly and Susie, Larry H., Marlis, Martha, Maxine, Melanie, Mike, Neil, Nell, Renee, Ron, Sarah S., Sophie, Ted, Theo, Wade, William. Please add other names silently or aloud. Alleluia. Hear us, risen Lord.
We lift up those who have gone before us into your eternal kingdom. Please say their names silently or aloud. And may those who mourn be comforted. Alleluia. Hear us, risen Lord.
Resurrecting God, as revealed to us in Christ, we pray for open hearts to accept your gifts of grace as we journey with our companions through life.
Amen.
Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Hello, my name is Liam Morley. I've been a member of St. James my entire life. I grew up knowing about the relationship that we had with our friends in Haiti, and it culminated in my trip to Haiti in 2018 that I took with our group. I got to visit Biganay, Jacmel, and Port-au-Prince, as well as some places in between. And I love and cherish so many memories that I have going there, and also from growing up with the relationship, seeing the art sales, meeting the people who come to us. Growing up with the relationship, my attention was on it in particular because my grandma, Ruth Ann Olson, had dedicated so much of her time and energy to sustaining the relationship, welcoming the people, and interacting with them. I knew she had gone to Haiti multiple times with my grandfather. She brought me back art, and I admired those who went because it seemed they did so with kindness and respect, and they really learned a lot. I felt even then that just to hear my grandma talk about it was not quite enough. That was really important was interacting with the people, whether they came to us or we went to them. really facilitating conversations, exchanging stories, and learning from each other, building that relationship instead of having it just being one-sided, us helping them. Going to Haiti then was really, really significant for me. It was the first time I'd ever traveled outside of the United States at all. And I'm really happy that that was the first place I went, because I think it's different than like a trip to Europe would have been. I saw a lot, and like I said, I had so much fun. I cherish a lot of the memories I have. I just want to tell you some of the most important things that I feel I've learned. The most important things I took away from Haiti and our relationship with Viganay and Bonneville are these. For the first time, I understood what it meant to be really noticed for your skin color. And I will never forget that feeling. Obviously, I've grown up here in Minnesota, and we have people of color for sure, and I've grown up around them, but definitely there's a large percentage of the population which is white, and a lot of the neighborhoods that I grew up in, the people that I interacted with were white. And so to go to Haiti, where it's predominantly people of color, and really the only white people that I saw were the ones who already came with me, was really significant, because I felt noticed in my skin color for the first time. This feeling is absolutely significant to me, and I will take it with me. I'm glad that I experienced that, and I am so fortunate to have gone to see that. I bring that feeling back with me and back to my relationships with people of color here. And it has definitely influenced my engagement in social activism, especially regarding race. The second important takeaway from Haiti is, it may seem a little obvious, but we are all people. That's kind of it. We are all people, and we all have the same capability for love and happiness and kindness and joys and sorrows, no matter where we are, where we grew up, who we are, where we come from. It really is, we are all people. Coming together with people who are different than you, you actually end up finding more similarities than you would have expected. And that was really one of the greatest joys of going to Haiti for me. I cannot overstate how wonderfully kind and welcoming our Haitian friends were to me and our group. And I can only hope that they felt as welcomed by us when they came here. I am grateful to the partnership for giving me the opportunity to be exposed to and learn things that I may never have otherwise. Thank you.
May the one who brought forth Jesus from the dead raise you to new life, fill you with hope, and turn your mourning into dancing. And may Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless and keep you both now and forever. Amen.
Good morning and welcome to this sixth Sunday of Easter. This week continues our Haiti Pledge Drive to support our partners with Bonne Nouvelle in Bijonais, Haiti. Parishioners are asked to return the pledge card that you should have received. Information about this partnership can be found on the St. Luke's and James website. Thank you for joining us. Just a reminder, we begin our Sunday mornings at a gathering time at 9:30 on Zoom. We ask that you stay with us for our pre-recorded YouTube service, which you can find on the web link provided. That service starts at 10 a.m. And after the service, we welcome and ask you to join us for our virtual coffee hour, which is also provided on a Zoom link, where we have great fellowship and good discussion, followed by announcements. Then after announcements, we have our adult forum, where we share ideas, we gather new learnings, We experience new things, and we exchange information about what's going on in our community, what's happening in our faith life, and what's going on in the broader world around us. So I hope you can join us for that adult forum and come back and visit us every single Sunday. Christ is risen. Go in peace. Share the good news. Alleluia, alleluia. And thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.